Hello again and welcome to my next video on a triangle. I can't believe I'm doing this, by the way. Okay, I want you to imagine for a minute that I'm a concert percussionist and I've applied for a position with a major orchestra. I'm invited to go for an audition and I'm sent a 74-page document entitled Requirements for Audition. So this document lists the excerpts of music I'm required to play at the audition. For example, I have to play a bass drum excerpt from Stravinsky's The Rite of Spring. I've got to play something with cymbals from Tchaikovsky's Fourth Symphony, a tambourine part from España by Chablier, and a wee glockenspiel excerpt from Debussy's La Mer, and so on. I'm also going to have to play a handful of excerpts featuring the triangle. Something from Britten's Young Person's Guide to the Orchestra, from Carmen Suite by Bizet, from Dvorak's Symphonic Dances, and from Rachmaninoff's Symphonic Dances. The document I received has got the scores for these excerpts and it has details of the instruments I'm expected to play. They provide them, although I am allowed to use my own triangle, thank goodness. All of this happened, but obviously I wasn't involved. If you saw the first video, you'll know that I can only play primary one triangle. I found this whole scenario online. The position was sub-principal percussion with the New Zealand Symphony Orchestra, and the audition took place in March last year. I have no idea who got the job. So I thought I'd play an excerpt from Young Person's Guide to the Orchestra, which this person was invited to play at the audition. Of course, in the audition, the percussionist couldn't hide behind the noise of the orchestra because you're going to hear the full orchestra playing this excerpt, which will last for just over a minute. Did you hear the triangle in that piece? I wonder how much practice the percussionist put in before auditioning for that piece. He must have been quite nerve-wracking for the poor person. I still have to play in this audition the triangle part from the Dvorak Slavonic Dance number 10. And I thought I'd play that now, but I'm not going to play just an excerpt. I thought I'd let you hear the whole piece. There are two bits in this work that feature the triangle, but rather than listen out for them, why not just enjoy the whole work, because it's lovely. Dvorak wrote a set of 16 pieces collectively known as Slavonic Dances in 1878 and 1886. He wrote them originally for piano, four hands. And here's number 10. It's a magical waltz that somehow superimposed beauty and sadness, if you like. So let's hear it. ¶¶ long note at the end, and it's a lovely piece that. Okay, let me just fiddle about with my phone until I source the next piece. But before I do, though, let's maybe talk just a wee bit about the triangle. It's usually made of steel, but sometimes of copper, and it isn't quite a triangle, of course. One of the angles is left open, with the ends of the bar not quite touching. And having this open corner keeps the instrument from having a specific pitch. Generally, the outline is of an equilateral triangle, but earlier instruments, I'm told, were non-equilateral isosceles triangles. I thought I mastered the triangle at primary school, but I fear I didn't. It's by no means a simple instrument to play, would you believe? Controlling the volume can be quite tricky. For instance, sometimes percussionists will use knitting needles and for a quiet note. Sometimes they would use wooden beaters to give a duller tone. And how the triangle is actually held can modify the tone as well. Anyway, let's have a piece which is quite familiar, the Brahms' Fourth and Final Symphony, which he wrote in 1884. I read quite recently a piece in which the writer was quite adamant that Brahms was the first composer to use the triangle in a symphony, and that's a lot of tosh. The triangle appears in Beethoven's Ninth, and it's Schumann's First, in Haydn's 100th Symphony, and goodness knows how many others. Anyway, it does make a significant appearance in the third movement of Brahms' Fourth. In some performances, I've heard it appears somewhat modestly, and in other times with a wee bit more prominence. So let's hear it now, and I think maybe reflect on the fact that here we have a 54-year-old genius, Brahms, writing music for a triangle. Thank you. Some composers chose to ignore the triangle completely, the Philistines that they are. Some like Mozart and Beethoven used it sparingly, but some such as Mahler and Berlioz seem to embrace the instrument. And so I've got two pieces of Berlioz that feature the triangle. The first comes from the third act of his opera The Damnation of Faust, and when it was premiered in 1846, it was described as one of the most, this particular piece was described as one of the most original minuets ever written. It starts in a fairly conventional way and then it kind of meanders off into all sorts of unexpected directions, stopping and starting as it goes. So let's hear it now.
Thank you.
Great stuff. I think of some fantastic composers around the time Berlioz was working, but I have a confession to make. Berlioz is my favourite of that era. Okay, so I'm going to try to squeeze one more in. I would have liked to have played the Adagio from Harold in Italy by Berlioz. It features the triangle to some effect, but sadly it runs for the best part of a quarter of an hour, which is too long for this programme. And I have a wee bit of a warning about this piece that you're going to hear now. I have a suspicion that it may also be too long. We have limited time where we can do these videos for, not much more than half an hour each, and this may run over. If it does, if the video stops towards the end of the piece, my apologies, but we'll see if we can squeeze it all in. You're going to hear the Roman Carnival Overture, which Berlioz wrote in 1844. Most of the music for this overture came from Berlioz's opera Benvenuti Cellini, which he wrote, I think, 6 years earlier. The opera was a spectacular flop. But strangely, this overture, with its kind of salvaged music, was an immediate hit. I can't help thinking that the triangle had something to do with that. So let's hear the Roman Carnival Overture, or as much of it as we can get in.
Thank you.
well, we got there, we made it. Well, that's today's video is over. I know the subject was frankly ridiculous, but I hope you don't mind, and I hope you enjoyed the music. Goodbye.